So if you're new here, that's awesome. But if you're not, then we've got just a couple of refreshers for you. First, who we are.
I'm Jesslyn, and this is Carter. We're the youth pastors here at Owasso First Assembly.
Yeah, and first, we wanted to point out our guests, and we wanted to acknowledge our guests. So if you're a guest here, thank you so much for choosing to celebrate Easter with us. Here at Owasso First Assembly, we want to acknowledge you and thank you. So we have a couple things specifically for you. If you notice, on the seat back in front of you, you've got a QR code. If you'll scan that QR code, it'll lead you to so many helpful resources specifically for you as a guest. Not only do we have that QR code, but in the back, in the lobby, we have a place called Guest Central. And that place is obviously for guests. And if you go there, you'll get two things that will happen to you. You'll get gifts, and then you'll also get a handshake and a hug from either a volunteer or a pastor here on staff. So I encourage you, after service, you can run back there, go to Guest Central, and get plugged in, because we would love to have you a part of our Owasso First Assembly family.
Another great resource that you should use are the Connect cards, which are also in the seat back in front of you. That is a great way to communicate anything with our pastoral staff and leaders. This can be prayer requests, comments, or praise reports. We want to go through the seasons with you, so let us know what is happening so we can pray with you, weep with you, and rejoice with you.
Yeah, and that Connect card, you can get that from Church Center. And if you don't have Church Center downloaded, I encourage everybody in the room to download Church Center. Church Center is an app that is so helpful. I tithe off of it. I give off of it. I use it pretty much every single day. Church Center, you can access old sermon notes. You can stay up to date on events. Church Center is extremely helpful, but one of the most helpful things on Church Center is checking in. If you are here right now, we encourage you to check in on Church Center. Check in you and your family. All you have to do is go in there, go to check in tab, and then check in you and your family on Church Center so that we know you're here and so that we can stay connected with you.
Yes, there are so many different ways Church Center can help you in your walk with Christ. So if you are on there are tons of tabs, a tithing, there's a digital Connect card, there's ways to sign up with groups, or even just get registered for different events that we have, as well as checking in. My favorite part of Church Center is the calendar, because I have major FOMO, and so I can pull up that calendar and see everything that the church is doing and not miss out on any of it.
Yeah, and another thing on Church Center is groups. And you can go on there and see what groups the church has to offer. We have Wednesday night classes. We have Sunday morning CLC classes. We have so many opportunities for you. We have community groups. We have so many opportunities for you to get plugged in into a small group here in the church. And an awesome thing is we have new groups starting next week. Next week we have new groups. So if you have yet to get plugged into a group, maybe it's your first time here, maybe it's the first couple times, or you've been wanting to get plugged in, new groups start next week, and so it's a great time to jump in. So we encourage you to do that. But not only do we have groups for the adults in the room, but we also have groups for the kids.
Yes, we love investing into our next generation, so don't forget to always bring your kids and bring your youth students. We have things for them as well.
Yeah, and Jesslyn and I, like we said, we're the youth pastors here at Owasso First Assembly. And so if you have students youth age, we encourage you to bring them on Wednesday nights. Bring them to our Sunday school CLC classes. Bring them here on Sunday mornings, because we have something for them. We believe the Bible talks about raising them up in the right way and getting the Word of God in them at a young age. So we encourage you to get them involved, get them plugged in. Not only do we have a youth program for your youth age students, but we also have a kids program. Pastor Vince is in the back right now, pouring into your kids right now, telling them about Bible-based stories, telling about the gospel specifically straight to the kids in their position. And so it's an awesome place. We believe that the Owasso First Assembly is a multiple generational church. And so get your kids plugged in. Also, we have Next Steps coming up. Next Steps is next week.
Yep.
So if you're new here, this is a perfect time to get to join, because Next Steps is something where if you're wondering, if you're asking yourself, what's the next step do I take in my faith? What's the next step do I take in my spiritual life? Or how do I get closer with the people of my community in Owasso First Assembly? Next Steps is a great way to do it. It starts next week, And if you're interested in it, if you're wanting to know more about that, go to Guest Central or talk to somebody about that today.
Yes. If you are new or new-ish and you want to get to know our pastors and leadership better, we have pizza with the pastors here at the church at 6 o'clock on April 28th. This is just a great way to get to know the people that are also new to our church in our area and get to know the pastors just a little bit better.
Yeah, and stay updated on the latest events and the latest updates that we have for you as a church. We encourage everybody to follow us on social media. We have social media platforms for every single group. We have social media platforms on Instagram, on Facebook, on YouTube. We encourage you to follow us on social media for the latest updates and also for spiritual encouragement. We don't just push out information, but we push out spiritual encouragement. So follow us on social media to stay with the family.
Yes, and if you're not able to join with us in person, we have online services as well. They are taken in the mornings on Sunday mornings, so you can hop on and join with us and be in real time so you don't miss out on anything. That is on Facebook and YouTube. Pick a platform and join us.
Yeah, but that's all the announcements that we have for today. But we just want to say thank you so much again for choosing Owasso First Assembly to celebrate our Savior's Resurrection Sunday.
Judgment, he was taken away, yet who of his generation protested? For he was cut off from the land of the nations kneel and glorify the Lord. Let all the earth tremble, for he comes, and he will judge the living and the dead. Son of man, coming on the clouds, the trumpet sound, every knee will bow, and tongue confess the name above all names. His name is Jesus. His name is Jesus. His name is Wonderful Counselor, Almighty God. His name is Jesus. His name is Jesus. His name is Wonderful Counselor, Almighty God.
Very early, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? She is not here. She has risen. Remember how he told you, while he was still with you in Galilee, that the Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again." And then they remembered these words. Now Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be taken advantage of. Rather, he made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has exalted this Jesus whom you crucified, and made him the name that is above every other name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, in heaven, and on earth, and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
He's Counselor, He's Mighty God, He's the Prince of Peace, the Omnipotent, He is Wonderful, He is Radiant, Almighty God. He's Counselor, He's Mighty God, He's the Prince of Peace, the Omnipotent, He's Wonderful, He's Radiant, the Almighty God. His name is Jesus. His name is Jesus.
Hebrews 12:2 tells us, for the joy upset but for him, he endured the cross. What was this joy? What was he so excited about? What was he thinking? I can't wait for this day. He was looking forward to the day that he could be with you, where there's no more barriers between you and God, no more sin separating you and God. We can approach him today now with confidence because of the death and resurrection of Jesus. Are you thankful for that? We serve a God who loves you, who cares for you, who gave everything just to be with you. Let's lift our voices, let's stand today, let's lift our hearts, and praise God. He is risen.
The Lord is my shepherd. He goes before me. Defender behind me. I won't fear. I'm filled with anointing. As we are, my cup's overflowing. No weapon can.
Oh,
to the King of Kings. Generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who've gone before Him and all who will believe sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all.
Can we declare that this morning?
Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all. Oh, Jesus, all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. And your people sing, holy to the King of Kings.
Thank you. vibrant ministries and community engagement. At OFA, we believe in the power of community. That's why we offer a variety of grow opportunities where you can connect, grow, and build lasting relationships. Whether it's through Sunday night community groups, our Christian living classes on Sunday mornings, or our Wednesday night groups, there's something for everyone to deepen their faith journey. We also have a strong commitment to the spiritual development of our next generation through our youth and children's ministries. Every week, OFA Youth and Uptown Kids provide a safe and nurturing environment for young hearts and empower God's people. In addition to individual growth, we're about family. That's why we host events for the entire family. Visit us online at awassofirst.com or download the Church Center app to learn more about our community.
Day. Now, it's good to set a day aside for a day of worship, a day for family, a day for rest. All the things that need to happen on this day, it's good to do that. But we worship today because Jesus rose from the dead on Sunday. It changed the way religion was even looked at. What day do we celebrate? We're here today because of what Jesus did, his resurrection. It changes everything. If you got your Bible, if you got the notes, we're looking at Mark chapter 16. Would you stand with me as we read the Word of God today? We don't do this every week. We don't have a tradition that we feel like we have to do, but we do this in honor of God's Word, to give reverence and respect and to give ears to hear. Mark 16, 1 through 8, in the New Living Translation, says, Saturday evening, when the Sabbath ended, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Salome, went out and purchased burial spices so they could anoint Jesus' body. Very early on Sunday morning, just at sunrise, they went to the tomb. On the way, they were asking each other, who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb? But as they arrived, they looked up and they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled aside. When they entered the tomb, they saw a young man clothed in a white robe sitting on the right side. The women were shocked. How many of you think that's the understatement of the day? Women were shocked, but the angel said, don't be alarmed. You're looking for Jesus of Nazareth who was crucified. He isn't here. He is risen from the dead. Look, this is where they laid his body. Now go and tell his disciples, including Peter. Mark records that part because Peter denied the Lord three times. Later on, John's going to show us where three times Jesus asking the question, Peter, love me. And it wasn't to rebuke him, it was to affirm him. It was to remind him, you denied me three times. I'm going to give you the chance to proclaim your loyalty to me now for three times. Go tell yourself and Peter that Jesus is going ahead of you to Galilee. You will see him there just as he told you before he died. The women fled from the tomb, trembling and bewildered. And they said nothing to anyone because they were too frightened. Now, I think sometimes, because we know the story so well, we forget the human emotion of this moment. It's interesting, you know, we think, well, that would have been a time where you just went, wow, that's incredible. These guys are, to use our words, saying they're kind of freaking out just a little bit. What in the world is going on? And they didn't tell anybody because they were too afraid. Then they briefly report all this to Peter and to his companions after Jesus himself sent them out from east to west with the sacred and unfailing message of salvation that gives eternal life. Amen. Father, I thank you for your word today. I pray that it would cause our hearts to be transformed. I thank you, Lord, there's power in your word. There's power through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. There's power through the coming of the Holy Spirit. And through those aspects and avenues of your power, we believe today for your will to be done. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may be seated. The most significant event in the history of the world is the resurrection of Jesus. It sets apart from every other religion something that is unique and different. By the way, let me just throw this in now. It wasn't in my notes. But to give you these two points of reference, if you're looking for a couple of good books that talk about the resurrection of Jesus, the first one I would recommend is Josh McDowell's book, Evidence That Demands a Verdict. It was written back initially in the late 70s, early 80s. I remember getting one of the first copies of that book when I was college age, probably. And it's not a light reading book. It's written more as like a research document. If you understand up front, if you go, I'm going to read four chapters tonight, probably not. It doesn't quite read like that, but it has research information about what he came up with. One of the thoughts he came up with this, so I'm jumping ahead, but let me throw it out for you right now. There's basically over 300 prophecies in the Old Testament that all speak to the coming of Messiah. All of those prophecies, some dating 1,000 years prior to the birth of Christ, all of them came true. They were fulfilled completely. Now, for those of you that like math, say no one ever in the room. No, I'm just kidding. Some of you probably do like math. I like math. For those of you who like math, Josh McDowell started writing this book because he was a skeptic. research. And one of the things that he did, he got a mathematician, a doctor of mathematics, whose specialty was in statistics, to analyze what was the probability of all of these prophecies coming true. I just tell you this, it's one with so many zeros behind it that it fills up a whole page of paper to get one in that many. And he looked at eight of the major, there's like 60 categories of the different prophecies, the different things they relate to. He looked at eight of them which were not controllable by the person. Like how many of you know you weren't able to control where you were born? Wherever you were born, that's where your mom happened to be on that day, and that's where you were born, but you couldn't just make up your mind, I think I'd like to be born in Chicago or New York City or Paris, France. You didn't get to choose that. That's why I'm from Paul's Valley, Oklahoma. I didn't get to choose that. It's just, that's the way life played out. That's the way it worked. So there are eight of these major categories that were not controllable by the person. And the research that was done by this statistician said that the odds of that, those eight coming true would be the same. You can read the whole book later and get all of these stories. Would be the same as if you covered all of the state of Texas in silver dollars up to your knee. You painted one of them red, dropped it in the middle, stirred it up, and said, good luck, go find it. How many of you would not like to be in that kind of a contest? The fact that Jesus fulfilled the Old Testament gives proof of the resurrection. Another book, and there are two or three in this series by Lee Strobel, is called Case for the Resurrection. There are others beside that, but that's a couple. I'm not going to try to prove the resurrection today, so I thought I'd throw those things out for you up front. Just let you know there's a lot of material that will help with this, and I'll be glad to talk with you about it. But it's important we recognize the resurrection changed the history of the world, a significant event. When Jesus rose from the dead, he reframed death. Up until his life and death, death was always the end. Death was always the conclusion. There wasn't anything that we knew after that point in time. From our human perspective, it seemed like it was the separation that we don't know what's beyond that. We know historically, reading through the Old Testament, that life is eternal, but we did not understand it clearly until Jesus illustrated it by his own resurrection. And what he did, he changed death from being a time of finality, of conclusion, and instead he transformed it into a place that not ends with this separation that's, you know, we don't know what's beyond it, to an entrance into eternal life. The resurrection, not a very common thing to have happen. My friend here in town, Steve Mowry, that owns Mowry's Funeral Home, he says pretty much death, he's batting 1,000. Everyone he's buried has stayed down there. It's only because the rapture hasn't happened yet. There is a day when we will be restored completely, but Jesus brought all of that into play because of his resurrection. And we know that when we die, we are with the Lord at that moment because Paul teaches us that. Jesus reframed death. There are moments in time when things change quickly. How many of you understand that's what happened in the life of Jesus his last week? He's coming in at the start of the week and they're all cheering for him. They're all yelling, Hosanna. And then by Friday morning, probably a different group of people. There were literally over 100,000 people. There were hundreds of thousands of people gathered in Jerusalem for the Passover celebration. And probably a different group, people that had been bribed and paid to come to this trial that was started at 6 o'clock in the morning. But it changed from being one of victory to one of difficulty. For the disciples, things can change quickly. And therefore, we must be ready at all times for whatever changes happen in life. Preparation and alertness are required to experience the benefits of opportunity that can bring change, or to prevent the devastation that can create change. In a couple of weeks, in a few weeks, I'm going to look at the story of the rich man in the Bible who said, I've had a great year. I need to build more houses for all the wonderful things that I have. My harvest is so big, I need bigger barns. I need more storage space. Sound like a modern-day problem to you? The Bible said that night his soul was required of him. Things can change good or for bad, and we must always be ready. The resurrection of Jesus is a biblically proclaimed fact, not a maybe, not a perhaps, a definite shout of assurance. He is risen. It's the critical truth on which the entire gospel hangs. 1 Corinthians 15, 14 through 22. Paul gives this if-then comment for us here. He says, and if Christ has not been raised, and if he did not raise from the dead, then our preaching is in vain, and your faith is in vain. We are even lying because we're testifying that God raised him from the dead. If he did not rise, if the dead are not raised, not even Christ was raised. And if Christ was not raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins. Boy, I'm glad the verse doesn't, the chapter doesn't stop there. Then those also who fall asleep in Christ have perished. If in Christ we have hope in this life only, we are of all people most to be pitied. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead. The first fruit of those who fall asleep. For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive again. This is really a fundamental point of discussion of our Christian faith. There are some who have so much confidence in their own ability to reason and to use logic that anything they can't understand, they dismiss. If it doesn't make sense to me, it must not be true. The reality is all of us are finite. All of us have limitations. And faith does not necessarily contradict logic. It rises above it. It's built on logic, but it's a higher level of understanding, looking at it from a godly perspective instead of a human perspective. In this, we understand the reality that when we say Jesus rose from the dead, this is not some symbolic thought. This is not some just a representative idea. This is a fact of life. Jesus physically died, and he physically rose again from the dead. It's proclaimed throughout all of Scripture. Jesus made numerous appearances to his followers. He made promises that he would rise from the dead. With the promises, you can imagine, again, we know the story, so we wonder, how could they be lacking in faith? Understand this. If somebody at work tomorrow shows up at your office and says something to you like, yeah, in just a few days, they're all going to kill me and bury me, but I'm going to rise again. You'd probably be talking to your coworkers and friends like, what do you think they mean by that? And you'd probably be interpreting that to mean the IRS is coming after them. Or maybe the mob put a hit on them. Or something's going to happen of a significant nature. But they've got a plan to escape it somehow. So the disciples were so confused when they heard these words saying, what do you mean he's going to die and rise again? You mean, what do you think is going to happen? And every time Jesus would tell them, I love the way that Mark shares it, three times in three successive chapters, Mark tells a story. And the first time that he tells them, I'm going to die and rise again, they're like, okay, that's good. And they just kind of want to go on with conversations. They do it again, and they're like, we don't even want to talk about it because we don't know what he's saying. We're afraid we're going to make him mad. The third time he says it, they look at him and they go, hey, Lord, can you do a favor for us? I got to tell you, it's a good thing that you and I weren't Jesus in that moment, because I think I would have gone off on him. Can I get a witness? But Jesus, in patience and love, keeps telling them the truth of what's going to happen. And then after it occurs, then the light clicks on. Oh, that's what he meant. He really meant he was going to rise from the dead. It is a biblically proclaimed fact, and any religion, any quote Christian group that says he didn't really rise from the dead, it's only representative, it's only theoretical. They are mishandling the Word of God. The Word of God is clear. Jesus died for our sins, and he rose again for our justification. And because he lives, we shall live also. That is the heart of the gospel. I know our logical minds go, I don't comprehend that. That's when you got to let your faith kick in. Jesus made numerous appearances to his followers. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, again, it says he was buried and raised from the dead on the third day. Just as scripture said, he was seen by Peter, then by the 12, and after that by more than 500 followers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. They were seen by James, later by the apostles. Last of all, as though I'd been born at the wrong time, I also saw him. Paul is saying that Jesus revealed himself repeatedly to prove that he was alive. The followers of Jesus, here's another proof of the resurrection. The followers of Jesus believe in this so strongly. In that century and every century since, there have been people who have said, I would rather suffer, I would rather be tortured, I would rather be put to death than deny the resurrection of Jesus Christ. If this is a hoax, somebody's going to give up. If this is a hoax, somebody's going to realize this isn't worth the price I'm going to pay. All of these people through the centuries, and even many today in our world, are suffering because they will not deny this truth. Jesus rose from the dead. As a matter of fact, the church has grown around the world, not despite the resurrection, but because of the story of the resurrection. The resurrection isn't something we put over in a corner and hope nobody notices or brings up. Let's just talk about how to be good people, but let's don't talk about that resurrection thing because nobody will believe that. No, let's bring a resurrection straight center point of the story. Jesus Christ died for our sins. He rose again for our justification. And because of that, we can have eternal life. If he was just a good man, then all of this makes no sense. But he is the Son of God who has the power over death. Jesus Christ rose from the dead. The second thing, the resurrection of Jesus transformed his followers. I could go into this for a long time, but I'm going to just give a quick glimpse. The crucifixion was filled with dismay. The crucifixion was filled with a sense of not understanding, confusion. But the resurrection brought the light. I just have to believe that we've been there. There have been cameras at that point in time that could have recorded this on video. When they caught the faces of his followers, they would have had a look of disbelief. Everything that we've worked for, everything that we hope for, this is not the outcome that we expected. Now let that bring a bit of encouragement to your heart. If you ever think in life, this isn't what I was really expecting, you're in good company. Neither did they expect to see Jesus nailed to a tree. They did not have the understanding of God. They did not have the faith to see it at that moment, and probably neither would we have at that moment in time. They were filled with dismay, discouragement, downheartedness. Oh, but Sunday's going to change the story. Now, I like that on Sunday, I think it's in John's Gospel, on Sunday it talks about even on Sunday afternoon, they're still hiding in the back room with the doors locked for fear of the Jews. That would all change because Jesus came through the locked door. And he brought life, and he brought life. John chapter 1 says that's what he does. The crucifixion seemed like a tragedy, but the resurrection was a triumph. The crucifixion is filled with fear, but the resurrection brings courage. And by the way, it culminates in Acts chapter 2 when the Holy Spirit comes upon them. And the same guy who couldn't even tell people, couldn't even tell a little teenage girl that was a servant girl that he was a follower of Jesus. He couldn't do that because of fear. After the day of Pentecost, he stands up in front of the thousands and he declares to them, Jesus Christ is Lord. They say, what's going on? He says, I'm glad you asked. Let me tell you what has happened. Jesus has risen from the dead and the Holy Spirit has come now to give us power. The crucifixion was filled with doubt, but the resurrection brought assurance. I love in John chapter 20, in verse 2, that they say to the angels in the tomb, we don't know where they've put him. other of the Gospels kind of give this same sentiment. We don't know where he is. We're looking for Jesus, and we don't know where he is. And the angel says, why are you looking for someone who's alive among where dead people dwell? He's risen. And we hear their story. We hear their words change. We hear Mary's words change from, we don't know where he is, to, we have seen the Lord. He is alive. He has brought transformation into our hearts and to our lives. Jesus filled them with assurance. The resurrection gives power today for his followers. Faith in the resurrection changes us from being spiritually dead to being alive to God. Ephesians chapter 2 talks about this and says that because of our sin, because of our unbelief, because of our hardness of hearts, that we were far away from God. We were spiritually dead, but he has now made us alive. He has breathed into our hearts and given us fresh life. Faith in the resurrection replaces guilt and condemnation and gives instead a celebration of forgiveness and freedom. I said this on Friday night. I did it in the first service. I said, if it went good there, I'd do it again for you guys. So it did. So I'm going to try this again. Often the devil will use the same tactics against us. Often he'll say something like this: you've done too much wrong to be forgiven. How many times are you going to keep coming back to God after you keep blowing it? The Bible tells us, some of the scriptures we read earlier talk about that he died. We'll read in just a minute. Romans, this phrase again, he died once for all. Hebrews talks about it. He died once for all. That what he did one time was enough for everybody. And what he did when he died on the cross, it will cover all of your sins. And it will cover all of your sins and all of my sins. And not only your sins and my sins, but it's enough to cover all the sins of everybody that's in this room today. Not only everybody in this room today, but everybody that is in Northeast Oklahoma. Not only Northeast Oklahoma, but all of Oklahoma. Not only all of Oklahoma, but all of the United States. Not only all of the United States, but every nation of the world. Not only every nation of the world, but every nation of the world for all time since Jesus Christ died and was resurrected. His work was enough to cover it all. And if you want to compare how horrible you've been and why he can't forgive you, it's like trying to compare 1 inch to 100 miles. It is not even close. His grace is more than sufficient. His forgiveness is offered that whoever will receive him, he will make them a child of God. It's not about you, it's about him. It's about what he did. So often the devil tries to get us to put a magnifying glass on our own life and then to turn it around and minimize what Jesus Christ has done. Can I tell you, today is the day to magnify the work of the Lord. It's not that we make it better. We just look at it differently. We see it for what it really is. We see its power. We see its ability. And we recognize that what Jesus did was more than enough. And it has the power to transform our lives. Faith in the resurrection replaces our failed attempt to please God with motivation to follow the Lord. Several years ago, with a couple of the pastors, I wrote out this thing. They helped me write it, and it was intended to be just kind of a guide for life for us. We did it with the whole church. We called it our covenant with God. There are 10 things there that talks about things like this. We're going to use our words to build up and not tear down. How many think that's a good thing? A biblical thing. We're going to honor God with all of our resources. We're going to recognize the sanctity of marriage and family and do our best to make those strong and according to God's plan. We have like 10 things in there. We're going to come to the house of God and give our time to him. We have 10 things like that in there. Then we got to 11. As we're talking about it, we wrote this out kind of over a few days talking through this whole thing. We got to 10 done, and I don't remember which one of us said, but one of us said, the only problem is, at some point, we're not going to do all those things. We're going to have an off day. We need to put one more in there. Number 11 basically said this: we're going to examine our lives frequently, examine our hearts frequently, to see if we have, this is my word now, veered off the path. lets us work past our failed attempts and to be motivated by looking at the resurrected Jesus. The resurrection is the ground of our assurance. It is the basis for all our future hopes. It is the source of power in our daily lives here and now. It gives us courage in the midst of persecution, comfort in the midst of trials, and hope in the midst of this world's darkness. Romans chapter 6, Paul writes, "We are sure of this because Christ was raised from the dead, and he will never die again. Death no longer has any power over him. When he died once to break the power of sin. But now that he lives for the glory of God. So you also should consider yourselves to be dead to the power of sin and alive to God through Christ Jesus. Do not let sin control the way you live. Do not give in to sinful desires. Do not let any part of your body become an instrument of evil to serve sin. Instead, give yourselves completely to God, for you were dead, but now you have new life. So use your whole body as an instrument to do what is right for the glory of God. Sin is no longer your master, for you no longer live under the requirement of the law. Instead, you live under the freedom of God's grace." I hope you understand that thought. I think that you all get this. But some people misunderstand grace, and they think that grace gives them kind of a pass as it relates to sin. Well, it doesn't matter. Sin no longer has dominion over me, no longer has power over me, no longer is my master. So I don't have to worry about it anymore. Grace never leads us towards sin. Grace always leads us away from sin. Grace is the power to overcome our human tendency towards sin. I think it's important every day for us to ask God, "Pour your grace upon me today. Cover me with your grace so that I have power to live right, because Jesus Christ was resurrected from the dead. And that changes everything. There is hope. There is purpose." You to bow your heads with me for just a moment. This is often what I do on a day like this, but I know there are a variety of people in the room. Some never miss church. Some, it's maybe one of the few times that you come, and it's not just about how many times that you show up. It's about having the right relationship with God. Get the first thing to be the first thing, and the rest of it will take care of itself. I want to ask you today, how many of you would join me in making a fresh commitment to say, "I want to follow Jesus Christ. I want to give him my life. I want to walk in obedience to his word." Whether you've never done it before, whether you veered off the path, as I mentioned earlier, or whether you're walking hand in hand with him every day, I just want to ask you, how many of you will say, "Today is a day that I reaffirm my commitment," or maybe that I make a commitment to follow Jesus Christ? I think it's important that we periodically stop and reaffirm and refresh where we are. As a matter of fact, I would encourage you to do it honestly every day. It's a great way to start your morning off. Just today belongs to the Lord. This is the Lord's day, not just on Sunday, but every day of the week. And maybe you will join me today, and you'll say, "I want to reaffirm my commitment to Christ," or maybe I want to begin in that relationship. Or maybe you'll join me and raise a hand all over this room and say, "That's me today. I am a follower of Jesus. And I just make it known today that I'm following him, and I give him my entire life. First time, 50th time, 500th time, it doesn't matter. I'm a follower of Jesus." I want you to stand with me. And I'm going to say a prayer, and I'm asking you to repeat it after. Let me be very clear here. The Bible speaks about this a lot in the Old Testament. God is not moved by what comes from our mouth if it doesn't come from our heart. One of the real words of strong condemnation against the Old Testament people of Israel at one point was, your heart is far from me. It's a horrible thing. So it's not just in saying a certain word or the right phrase or getting it right, but it's letting your heart cry out to God. And let this be your heart's cry. I want to say this prayer, and I want to ask you to repeat it after me. Repeat it from your heart, not just your mouth. The Bible says that confessing Jesus as Lord is the foundation of salvation. Believe in your heart God raised him from the dead. Confess in your mouth that he is Lord. And here's what Paul says, you shall be saved. It's God's guarantee that when those two things are done, when those two things are done with a full heart of meaning, when those two things are done with right intention, salvation is granted to you based upon the Word of God. It's more than a formula. It's more than just going through emotion. It's getting a heart that's right with Him. When you repeat this after me, you say it together, dear Father, I thank you for loving me when I was a sinner. I thank you for forgiving me of all of my sin. Jesus, thank you for loving me and for dying in my place on the cross. And thank you, Lord, that you did not stay in the tomb, but you rose again. Receive your grace into my life. Help me to live for you in obedience and in joy. In Jesus' name. Amen. Would you just thank God for salvation right now? Said earlier, we are a church that delights in resourcing you with things to help you in your spiritual journey. And we have a library or a book area out front with a lot of resources, but particularly if you're a new believer, whatever that means to you is fine with us. But if you need more help in your Christian faith, and you want to know more, there's a couple of resources and packages together out there. They're free and no charge. I'd love for you to give as many as you need to give to friends or whatever. One is called the New Believer's Bible. It's got some articles that just help you understand what happens to become a child of God. And there's also a book called Now What? What Happens After Salvation? These two resources will help strengthen you in your Christian walk. They're available out front in the New Believer section out there. There'll be somebody to give these to you. Get one for you. If you've got someone else that's a new follower of Christ, get it for them. If you've always struggled, I really don't know what, I kind of grew up in it, but I need more help. And these are available for you out there. It will be our joy to provide them to you today. Can we sing one last song of worship to God and give Him praise and shout?
Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Jesus Christ, my living soul. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. This grip on me, you have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living soul. Hallelujah! Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah! Death has lost its grip on me. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
I'm thankful today for the resurrection of Jesus. Thank you so much for joining us today.
every April. We take one Sunday to honor them. And so we want to encourage you to join us that day and write a note of appreciation. It'll be in the lobby next week and the week after. Every year we take up an offering to bless them just a way of saying thank you. But this year they have chosen to give everything that comes in the offering to the building fund to pay off our debt. And I just think that's so cool. It just shows their heart and their commitment to this church, that they care way more about this church and how they might personally benefit from a day like this. So we're looking forward to honoring them in 2 weeks. If you'd like to give your time today, you can do that in multiple ways. Grab an envelope in front of you, drop that in one of the drop boxes.